Oh. Oh. Ah.
Right away, sir. Please make yourself comfortable in the chair.
Ugh.
Are you interested in toy spaniels, sir? If you start me off talking about them, Mrs. Willis says I don't know when to stop.
You'll not bore me, Mr. Willis. I'm fascinated by the process of breeding pedigree animals. Tell me, how do you breed the different varieties that I see on your wall?
As you can see, Mr...
Darwin. Charles Darwin.
Mr. Darwin, there are four colours of toy spaniel. Since the time of King Charles, we've even managed to shorten their faces. If you want to breed a dog with long ears, like the Cavalier King Charles, then you pick out dogs with longer than average ears to be its parents. If you keep doing this with successive litters over time, you'll produce a dog with extra long ears.
You must be very skilled at dog breeding, Mr. Willis.
I just respect Mother Nature, Mr. Darwin. I never breed together dogs from the same litter.
Very wise. My recent journey around the world has left me in awe of how Mother Nature shapes all the living things in this world. The selective breeding that you carry out in your hobby, she has carried out for millions of years on a much larger scale. In Argentina, I collected fossils of long-extinct beasts, gigantic armor-plated beasts called megatheres. You would think there was nothing on this earth quite like them, and yet they are so much like armadillos.
Mr. Darwin, I would never have taken you for an adventurer. I'm originally a country lad from Great Staunton in Huntingdonshire. You remind me of the vicar I once knew at St. Andrew's, our village church. How wrong could I be?
Actually, I nearly trained as a cleric, but that's a different story.
How did you come to travel to Argentina, Mr. Darwin?
After finishing my final exams at Cambridge in 1831, I received a letter from my professor and dear friend, John Stephen Henslow. He had encouraged my passion for natural history and geology at university.
What did the letter say?
It contained an invitation to become the companion of Captain Robert Fitzroy, the captain of HMS Beagle. The ship was planning to conduct a survey for the Navy off the coast of South America. The journey would last 2 years and provide a splendid opportunity for a man of science to study the plants, animals, and geology of the countries that would be visited.
Some perfume shaving oil, sir. You'll be the sweetest-smelling scientist in all of Westminster.
No, thank you, Mr. Willis. I'm sweet enough as it is.
Oh. Well, do tell me more, sir. How was life at sea?
Oh, I was an eager passenger, Mr. Willis, but a poor sailor. We left England on December the 27th, 1831. The ship's first destination was the Canary Islands in early January. We then continued onward to South America, which was reached by the end of February 1832.
What was Captain Fitzroy like?
We shared an interest in geology and together witnessed a volcanic eruption. After this, we saw mussel beds that had raised themselves out of the water, and we were able to measure how far the earth had risen up. It explained how one could find fossils of sea creatures 7,000 feet up in the Andes.
Goodness gracious!
Fortunately, I had plenty of time to myself during the explorations of South America. I never got under the captain's feet, and I was able to spend considerable time on land. I kept a notebook to record my observations, and during quiet times on board the Beagle, I would write up my notes in my journal, which I'm using now to compile my book.
How would you like your neck? Straight or tapered?
Oh, tapered, Mr. Willis. It wasn't all fun, however. I saw some things in South America I'd rather forget.
Such as, sir?
The horrific treatment of slaves in Bahia, northern Brazil. Captain Fitzroy and I had a blazing row over the subject of slavery. He told me how an owner once asked his slaves if they wished to be free, and was told they didn't. I asked him if he thought slaves could answer such a question honestly when it was posed by their master, at which the captain lost his temper, and before storming out told me that if I ever doubted his word, we could no longer live together. He banished me from his table temporarily, and I thought that my journey had come to an end. Both sides of my family have campaigned for the abolition of slavery, you see. My grandfather, Josiah Wedgwood, made a cameo depicting a kneeling slave asking, "Am I not a man and a brother?"
Wedgwood? The famous potter?
Indeed.
Well, I never. Was the argument worth risking the journey of a lifetime for?
We are all brothers, Mr. Willis. We all share the same common descent. Our differences are merely a sign of how humans have adapted to their environment wherever they live. Having a black skin does not make a man intellectually inferior.
Mr. Darwin, what you say about skin colour makes sense to me now. I know that dogs from colder climates have thicker coats. So it would make sense that human beings would be different in order to adapt to their climates. I've even noticed that with the hair that I cut. The last gentleman that I had in here, an Italian, had jet black hair. I've learnt that dark hair is always much thicker and stronger than fair hair. Perhaps that's because the people with that hair colour have evolved to adapt to the environment where they live.
That's an interesting thought, Mr. Willis. I'll put that in my notebook. I believe strongly that despite our differences, all humanity share a common ancestor. But I would go further and say that all animals and plants have a pedigree that unites it with every other one.
Well, how can that be, sir? Surely the Book of Genesis tells us that all animals and plants were created by God exactly as they are today. Whole on the first day of creation and perfect in every way. It couldn't all have happened by chance. Our old vicar at St. Andrews used to rubbish anyone who contradicted the Book of Genesis.
Oh, really, Mr. Willis? And how did he do that?
Well, he'd use the watchmaker argument. The old rascal used to pretend he'd thought it up himself. But I've since read that it was first put forward by a churchman named William Paley. It's simple, really, sir. I can explain what he said just by showing you my pocket watch. Our vicar would argue that something as complicated as this, with all its springs and cogs, could not have just happened. He would stand in the pulpit at St. Andrews and would hold up his watch to us in the front pews and tell us that it was obvious that it had been designed by an intelligent being. I can still see him now, thumping his hand on the lectern and looking me straight in the eyes. He told us that it was the same with all the living things in this world. They are so wonderfully complicated that they must have been made by a designer, and that designer must be God.
I have not mentioned this to anyone but my close friends, Mr. Willis, because I know how upsetting it sounds for those with a strong faith. However, my voyage has shown me clearly that plants and animals do not remain the same, but change over several generations. You yourself have witnessed this with your toy spaniels, have you not, Mr. Willis? I saw so much evidence that it was true on my journey to the Galapagos Islands. For example, the tortoises that I rode on.
Rode on, Mr. Darwin? But aren't tortoises only about 6 inches long?
No, these were giant tortoises, Mr. Willis. We rode them on the island and then took some of them aboard the Beagle when we left as a living supply of fresh meat.
Rather you than me, sir.
I did give one of the tortoises to Mr. John Wickham, one of the officers on the Beagle, and he brought it back with him to England.
But how do tortoises prove that animals have evolved over centuries?
People who live in the Galapagos Isles could identify which island each tortoise came from, because they all looked different. The islands were volcanic, so all the living things there must have originally come from the mainland of South America. Perhaps the forebears had managed to swim across to the islands and then had to adapt to the unique conditions found on each of the islands. Over centuries, only the tortoises best adapted to live on a particular island would have survived.
Are you saying that that's the case with all animals, sir? That they adapt and change in response to the conditions that they live in?
I suppose I am, Mr. Willis. I'm writing about this at the moment.
Oh, really, sir?
Yes, it's very controversial, this theory. The idea that plants and animals do not remain the same, but change over generations. Amongst scientists, this is known as the transmutation of species.
Is that the same process for the fossils that you mentioned, Mr. Darwin? Those huge beasts that look like armadillos?
Oh, the megatheres, yes, exactly. They may have been extinct, but they were too similar to the armadillo for their resemblance to have been an accident. Megatheres have evolved over thousands of years to become armadillos.
This is strange, sir. I've always thought that God created everything in a perfect way.
Mr. Willis, if the megatheres were perfect, they would have had no need to change.
But how can all the living things on this earth share a common ancestor, Mr. Darwin?
Well, think about your spaniels, Mr. Willis. Have you ever seen how similar the paws on their skeleton are to humans? All mammals share this pattern of limbs. To me, this is evidence that we all share a common ancestor.
But we're also different, sir. How can I be related to my King Charles Spaniel? That sounds absurd.
Mr. Willis, if you should take the time to visit London Zoo, you'll see an orangutan called Jenny. I've watched her keepers tease her and seen her throw herself on her back precisely like a naughty child. Her expressions are so human. If you saw her dressed up as a little girl, you would start to believe how closely we are related. Think of a tree. The orangutan and human beings are just twigs generated from the same branch.
Sir, I am but a humble barber. I fear your ideas would find a more receptive audience amongst your peers.
I fear the impact my ideas would have, sir. Not everyone is as willing to hear me out as you are. My tree of life would undermine everything the Bible has led them to believe. Even my dear Emma finds it hard to accept what I have to say.
Is Emma your sweetheart, Mr. Darwin?
She is, Mr. Willis. It's the reason I'm here today. I plan to propose to her tomorrow.
Oh, congratulations, sir. But I hope you know what you're letting yourself in for. There will be no more trips around the world if the future Mrs. Darwin is anything like my missus.
Indeed. I have been plagued with doubt, Mr. Willis. I will have less time and money for my studies, and I know I can't live the solitary life forever.
You're right, Mr. Darwin. We cannot live a solitary life. And despite what I often say, I could not do without my own dear wife.
It has to be, Willis. Look at my wrinkles in the mirror. I'm not getting any younger. I can picture myself with a nice, soft wife, with a good fire, and compare that with the dingy reality of Great Marlborough Street, and it really is no contest. I will marry Mr. Willis, that is, if Emma will have me.
Oh, she will, Mr. Darwin. She'll find you irresistible now my clippers have done their work. This cuts on the house. You must call in and let me know if she accepts.
Mr. Willis, it has been a pleasure to meet you. I'd best get home. I'm so nervous about tomorrow.
Mr. Darwin, there's not time in this life for worrying. There's time for work and time for love. That leaves no other time.